Okay, so we start with the fourth lecture of Professor Caffarelli on basic tools for the regularity theory on nonlinear elliptic equations.
Okay, so thank you very much. So today I will complete the proof of the Krylov-Safanov-Harnack inequality. Right, that said that if you have a solution of Aij, Dij of u equal to 0, mean b1, u bigger or equal than 0, Aij, no only ellipticity assumed in on Aij, uniformly elliptic, right? Then the sup of u in B1/2 is bounded by a constant u in B1/2. Okay. So yesterday I proved as a preliminary step the Aleksandrov-Bakelman-Pucci theorem. That says the following. Suppose that V is a solution of Aij, Dij of V equal to F in B1. And V is bigger or equal than 0 on boundary of B1. Then the sup of V minus to the n is controlled by the integral of f plus to the n. And was a particular domain D, right? And this domain D was the set where the convex envelope of V minus touched V minus. Convex envelope of gamma V minus touches V minus. Okay. I need another preliminary little lemma before I start. This is a sort of a real analysis Calderon-Sigmund type decomposition lemma, and says the following. Lemma. Suppose that in the unit cube of Rn, in Q1, I have two sets, A and B, and I know this, they have these two pieces of information. A is that the measure of A is less than delta. And second, for some reason, I am able to say the following. I'm going to say that B, whenever for a given cube, U, the density of A in Q that is the ratio between the measure of A intersection Q and Q surpasses delta, then I know that B contains the double Q. So these are hypotheses, right? I know that the measure of A is less than delta, and also I know this fact. This fact, in some sense, says that B covers in density a neighborhood of A. Then the conclusion of the lemma is that the measure of A is smaller or equal than delta times the measure of B. Okay. The proof, just an application of Calderon-Sigmund decomposition. Okay. So let me recall for you what is Calderon-Sigmund decomposition for a set. So you take the set A, you have the unit cube, and you have the set A. Okay. And the measure of the set inside the unit cube is less than delta. So you split it in four. And you check if there is any cube for which the measure surpasses delta. Let's say that this cube, the set here, surpasses delta. Okay. Then you keep this cube. You call it Q0, and you keep it. Okay. And whatever is left, you divide again in 4. And you look at those cubes whose density surpasses delta, maybe this one and this one. And so you keep them. And do that again. And those that surpass delta, you keep them. And that way, you form a sequence of cubes. Okay. By the Lebesgue differentiability theorem, these cubes cover A almost everywhere, right? Every point of density of A, one of these cubes, at some moment the density becomes as close to 1 as you want. Okay? So the union of QJs covers Q, covers A. The density of A on QJ, by definition, is bigger than delta, right? And also by the construction, the density on the previous cube, which is called the predecessor, is less or equal than delta. Like in this example, the predecessor of this is this one, right? Okay, so the density in the predecessor is less or equal than delta. If not, I would have chosen the predecessor, and I never reach QJ. Okay. So I do this covering of A. Right? And I look at all the predecessors. Okay. The predecessors still cover A. Right? And the predecessors, everything is ordered. If you take two predecessors, or one is inside the other, or they are disjoint. Right? Because these are all dyadic cubes, or one is inside the other, or they are disjoint. So I take this covering, I take the predecessors. And so on, right? And I can throw away the ones which are contained in the previous one. In other words, I can make of this covering by predecessors, I can make a disjoint covering, right? If this is contained in here, I throw it away. If this is contained before, I throw it away, and so on. Okay? So now the measure of A, right, is equal to the sum of the measure of A intersection this disjoint covering by predecessors, right? But in each of them, the density of A is less than delta. Right. And my funny hypothesis tells me that each one of the predecessors is containing B. Okay. So since these are disjoint and each one is containing B, this is a smaller or equal than delta times the measure of B. Okay. And it proves the lemma. Okay. Because that was my hypothesis, that B contains twice the cube, right?
Oh.
My hypothesis was that if some cube was in A, twice the cube, in particular, contains the predecessor. Okay. I mean, I could put as an hypothesis the predecessor is in B, but since you don't know which way the predecessor is pointing, it's the same. Okay. Okay, so this proves the lemma. So let's go to the proof of the Harnack inequality. So the proof goes in two steps. Step one says that if V is a non-negative supersolution, I'm going to do cubes from 1 because in Q1, because the geometry of this lemma asks for cubes. So if V is a non-negative supersolution in Q1, and it's controlled at a point then let's say in B1/2 or in Q1/2 V is in some weak epsilon. That is the measure of the set where V is bigger than lambda. Is smaller or equal than lambda to the minus epsilon for some epsilon. Right? If you think on harmonic functions, you have a super harmonic function, the value at a point controls the average of the function. So the harmonic function, a super harmonic function, which is 1 at the origin, right, is in L1 with integral less than 1. Okay. And the second step is the opposite, right? If you have a subharmonic function and you have some control on its integral, you know that the subharmonic function is bounded because the opposite mean value theorem. So step two says if W is a non-negative subsolution in Q1, right? And W belongs to weak epsilon, then W is bounded. Q1/4 or something like that. And when you put the two things together, you have that if you have a solution, then you have a solution whose value is 1 at the origin, then it's bounded. Okay. (coughs) Okay, the step one sort of will be a combination, will be two substeps. The first substep is a normalized statement in the unit cube, a control of measure, that is that the value, if V is one at the point, then in some set cannot be too large. And then an application, an iterative application of the AB lemma, right? It's again this phenomena that if you have this estimate for every dial H, at every scale, then that implies some stronger fact. Okay. So let me get, so we have the first day. So this will be the step 1A, right? So I have V super solution. So same hypothesis as before. V super solution in B1, super solution in Q1, V of 0 equal to 1, right? I want to show you that then V has to be bounded in a set of non-trivial measure. It cannot be that this has a very thin peak going to 1 and then it's almost infinity everywhere else. Okay? So let me do an argument and then I'll refine it. Okay? So I won't write still the lemma, right? But what I have in mind is if I have this situation, then V has to be less than some constant in a non-trivial set. So this is what I want to show. Okay. So let me first make a rough lemma and then I will improve it a little bit. Okay. So the first lemma is the first argument is the following. So here I have V and V is 1 over here and is non-negative everywhere else. Okay. So let me take, for instance, the ball of radius 1 and add to V 1 minus x squared over 2. So I want to look at the auxiliary function V tilde equal V plus or minus, this function is x squared minus 1 over 2. And 2x squared minus 1, right? Okay. So I'm adding this paraboloid, right? So the new graph is something like this. The important thing about V bar is that V tilde at 0 is minus 1. Okay. And L of V tilde, L of V is negative, L of this is bounded. So L of V tilde is bounded. Okay. So now I apply the Alexandro Bakelman-Pucci estimate. And I have the sup of V tilde minus is at least 1. Right? Is smaller or equal than the integral of f plus on the domain where the convex envelope of V tilde touches V tilde, right? But this is bounded, right? So this is smaller or equal than a constant times the measure of the contact set. So the measure of the contact set is strictly positive, so with an estimate. Some fixed constant theta, right? And there, V tilde is negative, which means that V is less than 2. Okay. Notice that if you turn this around, this is the DiGiorgi oscillation lemma. If you turn this around, so if you turn the picture around, you have that minus V is a subsolution, right? Is 1 over here. And therefore, we are saying that the measure over here is non-trivial. Okay.
What was the argument that the contact set is positive?
That the measure of the contact set is positive? Well, this F star, if the star for in that case was less than a constant, right? It's the right-hand side of L of V tilde, right? L of V tilde, L of V is a super solution, so L of V is negative. So L of V tilde is really L of X squared, which is bounded. It's bounded by the ellipticity capital lambda times 2n or something like that, okay? Okay, so this is bounded. The integral is bigger than 1. The domain has to have size. Positive side. Okay. Okay. This is almost what I want, but I want to localize that a little bit. I want to say not only that the set where V is bigger than 2 has non-trivial measure, I want to say it for any nearby little cube. Okay. So the lemma I want to prove really says the following. It says something like, suppose that V is bigger or equal than 0, is a super solution in Q1, V of 0 is equal to 1, then, let's say, for any cube of size 1 over 8, right, and center less than 1 over 8, the measure of the set where V is bigger than some constant intersection Q1 over 8 is bigger or equal than some theta bigger than 0. Okay. So the difference with the previous picture is, in the previous picture I have that V is 1 here, right? And I know that spread somewhere here there is a set where V is less than 2 of non-trivial measure, right? So this D is spreaded all over. I want to localize it a little bit. I want to say for any cube I take, there is a non-trivial proportion for any cube of size 1 over 8, okay? So this is just, this is a technical detail, okay? How do you do that? So, well, the proof is the same as before. Instead of using the function 1 minus x squared, you have to use a better barrier. You have to use a function which is like this. So, to prove, I do the same as before. I take V and I'm going to add it to it. I'm going to do a V tilde by adding an auxiliary function gamma. Okay? And gamma takes a little construction, so I won't do it. But the idea is the following. I want a gamma, that I want to take a gamma, which is a super solution outside of the cube. And for that, all you have to take is something like minus r to the alpha, right? So you take a gamma, which is a super solution outside of the cube, like this. And you radially symmetric, and you cap it inside of the cube with a quadratic polynomial. Okay? And you make sure that here is at least minus 2. Okay? So, and in the notes I did the construction. It's very elementary. Okay? So, if you plug this gamma in this argument, okay, then you still have, so what is L of V tilde now? L of V tilde now is L of V was negative, right? L of gamma is negative outside the cube. And so L of V tilde plus, that is what we need in the lemma, the F plus, right, is bounded and supported in the cube. Because outside this is super and also this is super. Okay? So if I use this auxiliary function instead of the quadratic polynomial, I get again that the sup of V tilde minus is 1, because I made sure that my auxiliary function was at least minus 2 here, and V is 1 here, right? So V is 1, my thing is minus 2, so the sup of U minus is at least 1. Okay. And by Alexandrov, it's smaller or equal than the positive right-hand side in the contact part. The contact part can only happen, can only take place where this is a subsolution, right? If it's a super solution, you cannot touch it by below by a convex function, right? So this D really happens inside the Q1-8. And so here you get D intersection Q1-8 of X. Okay. So if V is 1 at a point in any nearby cube, I have a chunk where V, V tilde, the contact, on the contact set, V tilde is negative, right? And therefore, V now is less than V tilde plus a constant. It's not 2 anymore, right? You have to take a constant M. Okay. Okay. So I get this lemma.
Less than M, not bigger.
Yes, yeah. That will make the proof much easier. It's okay? I repeat it? Okay? Okay. So I have that if I know that V is 1 at a point, and I look at any cube of size 1/8 nearby there is a chunk where V is less than M. And now I'm going to repeat this at every scale. In other words, now I'm going to take, so now I'll do the step 1b. Okay, let me point out something since we are here. Let me point out something. So I have this, I have my function v, right? I have this auxiliary function gamma, which I add to v. So I have this auxiliary function. This auxiliary function is C11, certainly, right? It has bounded derivative because it's an explicit construction. So it has bounded second derivative. I have subtracted V, gamma from V and build this, right? I took the contact set of V tilde with gamma, right? And I prove that this has non-trivial measure, okay? So this has non-trivial measure. It is the D, right? The contact set D intersection QI. Now, in this set, I know much more about V. Because in any point in this set, right, gamma has a tangent plane by below. A global tangent plane is convex. So in particular, V tilde has a global tangent plane by below. So this implies that V, which is V tilde is V plus gamma, right? So V, that is V tilde minus gamma, this has a tangent plane by below, so, and this is quadratic, has quadratic control, so that means that all those points, V has a quadratic paraboloid that is tangent by below, with control on all the coefficients, right? So in this set D, I have much more information about V. I know that V is bounded. I know that gradient V is bounded. Right. And I know that D square of V is bounded by below. Okay. So at least heuristically follows from the operator that D square of V is bounded by above. So on this set, I have control on the first and the second derivative. Which means that now when I prove the epsilon maximum is going to be good for V, for gradient V, and for the square of V. That is the fact that gradient V and the square of V are an epsilon are theorems of Craig and Fang Wall, right? So okay, let me prove the epsilon estimate now. So the epsilon is simply an application of this observation at every scale using this AB lemma. Okay. So let me call AK the set where V is bigger than m to the k. And I want to convince you that if I take the right delta, delta I think is 1 minus theta, right? Then I can AK minus 1, and AK satisfies the hypothesis of the AB lemma. Okay? So if we take this, and I want to convince you, Mark, AK equal A, and AK minus 1 equal B, satisfy the hypothesis of the AB lemma with delta equal 1 minus theta. Okay. So let me prove this remark. Proof. Suppose that for some cube Q, AK has density in Q bigger than 1 minus theta. So that means that V the measure of the set where V is bigger than MK, right, takes more than 1 minus theta of the cube. That means that where V is smaller than M to the K takes less than theta of the cube. Okay. Right. right? Because here I'm saying that the set where V is bigger than MK takes 1 minus theta chunk of the cube. So this takes less than theta times of the cube. Okay. Now, the previous lemma, if I now I apply the previous lemma to V divided by MK. Okay. So the previous lemma tells me that there cannot be any point near Q at the scale of Q where this is less than 1. Right? Because if there is a single point where this is less than 1, and then so I have here the cube Q, right? Everything is inside Q1, which is much larger. I'm working in Q1 half. Then if I have here this cube half, if I have nearby any point where V over MK is less than 1, right? The previous lemma tells me that in any proportional cube, V1 over 8, Q1 over 8, right, this quantity has to be less than M. Okay. And this is a contradiction, right, if I divide by MK here. I'm sorry, divide by MK minus 1. Is that clear? Okay. I take any, if this becomes less than 1 at any point, right? So I look at twice this cube, right? I look at twice this cube. And if this becomes less than 1 at any point, then I call this my Q18 after rescaling. I call this the 1/8 distance to the center or something like that, or 2/8, 1/4 distance to the center. If this becomes less than 1 at any point, then the measure where this has to be less than M, the measure where this has to be less than M has to go above theta, and it doesn't. Okay. So if the density of this cube in AK goes above 1 minus theta, there is no point nearby that can be on AK minus 1. Okay. You look all, you know, I'm not too too convinced. Let me do it. Okay. Okay, let me do it. So suppose that, so I want to prove that AK and it satisfies the hypothesis AB, right? So suppose that for some cube, AK intersection cube over cube go above delta. Right? I'm going to apply the lemma with this is A, this is B, and delta is 1 minus theta. Okay? So suppose that this happened for some cube Q. Okay? So I do the following renormalization. A expand Q to make it of size 1/8, right? Nothing changes. You just, the dilation of the function, of nothing changes. And consider V bar equal V over M to the K minus 1. Okay. Let me call this expansion Q star. 1/8. Okay. Then on Q star 1/8, V bar less than M, the set where V bar is less than M, right, is less than theta, the measure of the cube. Okay, it's just translation of this statement, nothing else. I take the cube, I expand it, I look at the set where V bar is less than M, that's the set where V is less than M to the K m to the k, right? Then this is below theta, okay? Now, I apply the previous lemma the other way around. The previous lemma told me if at the origin the function v star, v bar, is less than 1, right, the density in this cube has to be above theta. That's what the previous lemma tells me, right? I applied the other way around. I said the density in this cube is less than theta, right? That means at this scale, that means that if I take any point at distance 1, right, v bar cannot be less than 1. Because the previous lemma told me it is enough for v bar to be less than 1 at a single point to have this control in any nearby cube. Okay? So the previous lemma tells me that in Q1, around this Q18, v bar is bigger than 1. Q1 is the double of this cube, contains the double of this cube. Okay. So, in the double of this cube, V bar is forced to be bigger than 1. Okay. If I rescale, being the double is preserved under rescaling. So, I know that in the double of this cube, V bar is bigger than 1. That is, V is bigger than M to the K minus 1. So in the double of Q, V is bigger than M to the K minus 1. That is, the double of Q is contained in AK minus 1. And this is the AB hypothesis. If the density of the cube in AK went above this critical threshold, then the double is contained on B. Okay. But then this implies that the measure of AK is less than delta, the measure of AK minus 1. This implies that the measure of AK is smaller or equal than 1 minus theta, the measure of AK minus 1. And if you iterate, this is smaller or equal than 1 minus theta to the K, the measure of AC. Okay. So this proves the L epsilon estimate. Okay. So now I want to prove, so the second part, to complete the proof, so in particular this proof, since it proves the L epsilon estimate for V, for Vx, and for the second derivatives of V. Okay? Because the sets are the sets. You can do the same with the sets of the first derivatives and the second derivative. But these are just a remark. Okay, so now I want to prove the second part, and I said the second part says if W is now a subsolution and W belongs to L epsilon, then W is bounded. Okay. Okay, the idea of the proof is the following. So we are in Q, let's say Q1 fourth, inside Q1 half, inside Q1. I know that W is in L epsilon, and let me fix the L epsilon semi-norm to be 1, for instance. And I want to convince you that U is bound, that W is bounded, okay? So what I'm going to do is the following. I'm going to take a point x0 here, right? And then I'm going to assume that W is very large. So suppose that W is equal to M0. I mean, W nice, W is continuous. The important thing is the a priori estimate, okay? Then I'm going to say, okay, W is equal to M0. I'm going to take a cube around X0, right? And I'm going to study, I'm going to show that if I take the right size of the cube here, and W is M0 here, then W has to go across 1 plus delta M0. Okay, so I'm going to show that if Q of x0 has, now this is not too tiny, not too small, it will be a function of m0, and if delta is small enough, so if I look at the cube, which is not too tiny, and if I'm not too ambitious, that is, if delta is small enough, then just because W is like is M here, then the sup of W in Q has to be smaller or equal than 1 plus delta M. So I want to prove this, and I want to get what do I need this, what does this mean, and what does delta mean, okay? So the estimate will come the following way, okay? I'm going to cut here at level M0 over 2. Oops. And I'm going to assume that this is not the case, that for the cube Q, the sup of W is less than 1 plus delta M0. Okay? And then I want to show that if I assume that, right, then both the set where U is less than M over 2 and the set where U is bigger than M over 2 have measure less than half the measure of the cube, which cannot be. Okay. So I'm getting this estimate by assuming that if not, I'm going to prove that A, the set where U is less than M over 2, and B, the set where U is bigger than M over 2 have measure less than 1/2 the measure of Q. Okay. Now U is in L epsilon. Okay. So U is in L epsilon. That means that the measure of the set where U is bigger than M0 over 2, right, has measure M0 to the minus epsilon. Okay. So if I take the size of the cube to be 2 times that, then I'm done, okay? So I'm going to fix the size of the cube. The measure of the cube is going to be times minus epsilon. Okay. Notice that this is for M0 large, is a small number, it has geometric decay on M0, right? It's power decay on M0. So this fixes the size of the cube, okay? Now I want to choose the delta, okay? To choose the delta, I use the previous lemma, switching the picture, right? Okay, in other words, what does it mean, switching the picture? I have, now I have this cube, I forget about the rest, right? I mean, maybe I have to take twice the cube when I was cube. So I switch the picture, right? And if I switch the picture, I have to do what switching the picture means. I look at 1 plus delta M0 minus W, right? So since I'm assuming that the supremum of W is less than 1 plus delta M0, when I see the picture, this is non-negative, right? I want to make it 1 at the origin. So I have to divide by delta M0, okay? So this in the cube is less than 1 at the origin. So let me call this W tilde. This is, I switch it around, so now W tilde is a super solution. Super solution. W tilde of 0 is equal to 1, and therefore W tilde is in L epsilon, okay? So I want to say something about the set. Let's see, I already controlled this set, right? We agree that this is was less than half the measure of the cube. I want to say something about this set, okay? The set where U is less than M over 2, right, basically is the set the set where U is less than M over 2 basically is the set where I'm sorry, W, always W here. Is basically the set where here I have 1 half of the M over 2, right? So here I have something of order 1, and here I have delta, okay? So the set where W is less than M over 2 pretty much is the set where W tilde is bigger or equal than 1 over delta, okay? So the set where B is bigger, where W is bigger than less than M over 2 is to the measure of the set where W tilde is bigger than 1 over delta. Okay. And the set where W, by the previous lemma, the set where W tilde is bigger than 1 over delta is less or equal than delta to the epsilon, 1 over delta to the minus epsilon, right, times the measure of Q. Because this is a normalized situation, I'm just looking inside the measure of Q, right? If you want, I have normalized the cube to size 1, okay? And so here, all I have to choose is this delta so that this number is less than half. So delta is independent of M. All I need is to make this less than half. Okay. If I do that, I get a contradiction. Okay. So now,
I'm sorry, can you just say again, how did you get this estimate on the measure of the set where W tilde is bigger than 1 over delta?
This is the epsilon W tilde satisfies all of the hypotheses of the previous lemma. Since I switch it around from subsolution became supersolution, at zero, U was equal to M, so W by the renormalization is exactly equal to 1, and therefore the previous lemma says it's in L epsilon. Okay? Okay, so let me write the conclusion of the lemma. It says if a measure of Q, so if W is a solution in L epsilon, and W of x0 is equal to M, right? Then the sup of W on the cube of size M to the minus epsilon, I mean, maybe an epsilon, different epsilon, epsilon over N or something like that, right? The volume M to the minus epsilon. So in the cube of size, and the sup of W, the sup of W on the cube of size M to the minus epsilon, right, is a smaller, is bigger or equal than 1 plus delta. And now I iterate this lemma. I say so now we just iterate make a picture. I say, okay, here I have the cube of size 1 half or 1 fourth, and here u is equal to m0, right? Then in a cube, so u of x0, w of x0 equal to m0, right? Then that means if I take a cube of size m0 to the minus epsilon, there is an x1 which is bigger or equal than 1 plus delta m0, and x1 minus x0 is less than m0 to the minus epsilon. Right? And now I apply the lemma to x1, and then I get another point x2, such that W of x2 is bigger or equal than 1 plus delta m1. And x2 minus x1 is smaller or equal than 1 plus delta m0 to the minus epsilon. And I keep going, right? So W of xk is bigger or equal than 1 plus delta to the k m0, and xk minus 1 is smaller or equal than 1 plus delta m0 to the minus k epsilon, right? So the only thing I have to make sure is that this sequence doesn't go out of, the, say, the cube of size 1 half, right? If the sequence never goes out of the cube of size 1 half, I have a contradiction because I have that my function was continuous and there is a sequence where it goes to infinity. Okay? And so since this is a geometric series, all depends on the choice of M0. See, if m0 is large enough, the sequence never goes out of q1 half, and I have a contradiction. Okay? And this completes the proof. Okay? Let me point out to finish that, in fact, as I said, in the meantime, if we look at the information on these sets, we have proven that the first derivatives R and L epsilon. Okay? So, if you have an equation, a fully nonlinear equation, f of d square of u, right, we said that the first derivative satisfies a linearized equation. You can do it with incremental quotients if you are scared of taking first derivative. Right. So if you take, for instance, the positive part of u alpha plus is a subsolution in L epsilon, therefore is bounded. Okay. So if you have a solution of an equation like this, the first derivatives are bounded. And therefore, they are Helder continuous. So they are C1 alpha. Okay. If you take an equation which is convex or concave, right, we saw that the second derivatives, right, are subsolutions or supersolutions. You choose. And they are in L epsilon again. Okay. Then this shows that the second derivatives are bounded. So if this is concave or convex, right, because you show that the second derivative plus the positive part, for instance, or the negative, depending on the thing, is bounded, right? But then from the operators, they are all bound. If the positive part is bounded, the negative part is bounded from ellipticity. Okay? Then the norm of u C11 B1/2 is bounded by a constant. Okay, so I'll stop here and tomorrow I'll show the C2 alpha theorem.